Welcome back, everyone, to game number two between Mineski and Underminer. Game number one didn't really go Underminer's way. Mineski, even with a couple of stand-ins, three stand-ins, in fact, on their core roles, were just too much for them. Mineski do need these wins, though, and they're battling through a relegation to try and keep their spot up in the MLG Pro League. But let's head into game number two and see what we're dealing with here. And also welcome in Scat once again. How are you doing?
I'm okay. I'm a little bit shocked at how quick that previous game was. I wonder if we'll have such a like fast-paced action chaotic clashes, then suddenly a team wins in this game like we had last game.
Yeah, it was pretty nuts because it seemed okay for Underminer for the first 10-15 minutes. You know, sure enough, Shadowfiend gets a Shadowblade BKB by 13 or 14 minutes, whatever it was. He had a whole bunch of gold and a lot of kills. But you always had time on your side as Underminer. You had Tiny Wisp, you had Troll, you've got the capability to take Roche, objectives. You just needed the initial items. And Mineski knew this. They knew how item-reliant Underminer was and how important that Aghanim's was. You even saw the Viper heading into the enemy jungle to take stacks. Heroes just running in there, really taking control of the Radiant side of the map, and Mineski didn't give them an inch. But
yep. Last game, Mineski banning Razor in the first phase, leaving it this time, but banning the Viper. So I wonder if these teams scrim against each other and there's some kind of like sort of Death Ball-y metagame evolving from their scrims, because it feels like there's a sense in which that's what happened last game, and there's a sense in which first phase banning Razor or Viper has got to be targeted, that kind of thing, not allowing them to just Death Ball you.
Yeah, it's quite interesting, because Mineski picked the Viper last game, went for Midas, Mech, and then I didn't even see what his last items were. I know he was going for Yasha, so I'm assuming he finished off Manta style or something like that.
He got a Desolator and an SNY.
Yeah, Desolator. The good old school Desolator Viper, I mean, why not? So Underminer now, they've got to pick up some fancy heroes to try and beat Mineski in the early game. There's that line that a lot of the Filipinos use for Mineski. They call them intro boys. And I've really started using this, not out loud, but in my head when I'm watching a game. And it kind of comes back to what you talk about quite a lot. You know, the fact that the initial 10 minutes, the kills don't really matter that much unless you make something happen out of them. You know, you get some objectives, you get map control. Mineski are very good at getting those initial kills. But quite often, they're not very good at following through and making them, you know, matter a great deal. So they call them the intro boys because the introduction of the game, the first 10 minutes, they dominate lanes, they get kills, and they, you know, really stick it to their opponents. But after that, they quite often fall short.
Yeah, I like the name as well because I think this is a team that historically and the current version, they're quite good at innovating, at introducing like new ideas, just not so good at, you know, perfecting them or perfecting the execution of them. Although in the first game, I feel like they just played a little bit. And what? There's the Razor pick.
Second so pick
there's
Razor.
Something going on here. There's something going on here that we don't know about, which like Southeast Asian teams have been scrimming in the last few days, and people are like, "Yep, it's time to go back to the Death Ball." I don't know.
But even last week, when we were casting a ton of Southeast Asian games, we must have seen Mineski, and we definitely saw Underminer. And they were picking up things like Undying, and they were going for some early game strats, but against Rave and MVP, it wasn't really working out just because of that experience that those two teams have over them. But maybe because Underminer and Mineski, you know, they're kind of on level footing somewhat, especially in the MLG Pro League, that maybe they feel that they can play like this up against each other. Yeah, I think you're right. But Underminer banning out Bristleback and one more, while Skywrath and Troll taken out by Mineski.
There's no, like, time rating or something in this league, is there, for, like, tiebreakers?
No, it goes to tiebreakers, actual game tiebreakers, if there's a tie.
I was thinking maybe there would be a reason to try and play so aggressively. But as you said, yeah, last week we also saw strategies like that. So, I don't know, maybe there's some theory crafting brewing in the scene, and we haven't seen the final product yet. But who knows, maybe the meta will be solved first in Southeast Asia.
Who knows? So we're looking at Shadowfiend mid here most likely, with Earthshaker in that holding role. Queen of Pain and Razor though from Mineski. We've seen a lot of offlane Queen of Pain. Razor can go both mid and safe lane. We've got two heroes here that could potentially go into any role and any position. Safe lane Quap has even happened. just to try and get that Orchid as quickly as possible. And Queen of Pain now doesn't do that well against SF. Razor, I've not actually seen that matchup. Razor against SF, because Razor has completely fallen out of favor recently, while Shadow Fiend has seen a massive surge in his playtime. Razor, I guess, does decently against Shadow Fiend because he's got Plasma Field to nuke the SF from range, but also control the balance of the lane. So you can Plasma Field his lane as he raises yours, then Static Link to drain his damage and try and harass him back. But
it seems to me like the kind of lane where if once SF gets souls and gets some levels, the Razor's really screwed. And these days, SF seem to get their early value. I feel like, you know, an SF, once he has level 5 or level 3 Razor, unless he's like already been destroyed and Razor's totally outfarmed him, he surely just has the upper hand there. Razor can't run in it and link him because he's going to get hit by 2 Razors every time he does that.
Yeah. Well, there's a Witch Doctor for Underminer. So ES and Witch Doctor, they've got one zoning support in the Witch Doctor, and then Earthshaker obviously can play both defensively and aggressively on lanes. Mineski now. Where are you going with this draft? Come on. Show us the magic. Okay.
Okay.
Nothing too spectacular, just a plain old Vengeful Spirit.
Yeah. They showed us the magic missile.
Ha!
Haha, what a great joke. Okay, moving on from that terrible pun. Team Underminer have to pick something now. They've got both their supports, and they have a Shadow Fiend, so I suppose they might want a core which can frontline.
It's difficult, though, because the Skyrath ban is obviously a targeted ban, because seeing as you picked up Queen of Pain, you don't want that silence there to zone her out of lane. So I'm wondering if it is going to be co-op off lane just because of that Skyrath ban. But you need something to lock down the co-op. Earthshaker and Witch Doctor don't really do that. You stun, and then, Queen of Pain just blinks away. Maybe you bring her down to 100 or 150 HP. But I don't feel like, unless you land triple raises on that stunned Queen of Pain, she's actually going to die yet. So I don't know, you need a Hex, you need a Silence, but there are no core heroes that really give you that.
Well, Queen of Pain always a lot easier to kill if she blinks in than if she's saving the blink to blink out. Well, and it's the Sniper. Surprisingly, was that banned last game?
I don't know.
Was it just totally ignored? I feel like I might have just been totally ignored in last game.
We're too confused about, you know, the Viper pickup and all these unusual picks here. Now, Mineski, Queen of Pain, Razor, Vengeful Spirit. I'm just wondering where the Chen is. Where are these greedy supports that we're so often seeing that these two teams are just completely ignoring? Like, where's the Chen? Where's the Sand King? Where's... sure enough, Enigma's banned out, and people are scared of that. But
the series is kind of designing its own metagame. I know Sniper definitely wasn't banned in the first phase last game, and it wasn't picked at all, so maybe it was banned in the second or third phase, but really late pickup for a hero that by many is considered to just be the strongest hero at the moment, especially that Shrapnel being the widely considered to be the next spell that's going to get a change. Spirit Breaker.
Okay, so it's probably not going to be Queen of Pain offlane then. Spirit Breaker is the one that's picked up. Skyrath Mage is obviously a hero that does decently against him because you just rip through the HP with the Arcane Bolt rather than right clicks, which the Space Cow can sustain through.
These teams have kind of changed roles.
What the hell?
Because the previous game, Mineski had the Shadow Fiend and the Earthshaker. In the previous game, Underminer had the Spirit Breaker and the Vengeful Spirit.
What is that Centaur ban? Are they expecting Spirit Breaker to be in the 4 role as a support? And Mineski is still looking for an offlaner? I just don't see that's how it's going.
Well, Spirit Breaker does get played as a support, especially in Europe. I'm not sure about in Southeast Asia, but maybe they're just especially worried about the Centaur ultimate, or just... Actually, yeah, I don't know. I mean, if you think the Spirit Breaker is a support, like, why ban the Centaur, of all things? I suppose they've banned the Clock and the Bat and the Storm, yeah. So they're just banning things that can jump onto Sniper, like, blindly, just like... Tech Dull Sniper. I think that's their plan.
Yeah, I guess so. All eggs in the Sniper basket. Right. Shadow Fiend mid, Sniper safe lane. But this has put Underminer into a position where there are very few offlane heroes remaining. So Brewmaster's a pickup for them. They needed some kind of, you know, you said the frontliner. They needed some hero that can actually walk into fights or blink in Brewmaster's case, cause a little bit of chaos while Sniper is throwing shrapnels around, allow Shadowfiend the time to spam some razors. But Mineski have some pretty tanky heroes. They've got the defensiveness from Swap. Ventral Spirit will be there ready. Charge can be a defensive skill. If you charge into the back lines of Underminer and focus down the Sniper, there's going to be three or four heroes in front of him that you charge through. And already they have a couple of heroes that can close the gap on that little guy. Spirit Breaker and Queen of Pain both will be hunting him down and looking for that opening to bring down the Sniper as quickly as they can.
I have this feeling that there's a chance that Mineski could just dominate both the solo lanes. They're on a safe lane Queen of Pain versus off lane Brewmaster that's meant to be pretty good for the Queen of Pain. And Razor, as we said, can dominate the Shadow Fiend right at the start if it gets that really gets off that really good start and gets the creeps in the first few waves. So we could see very one sided lane stage. I'm not sure. I mean, part of it's gonna depend on if this is a support or off lane are being picked up now.
Yeah.
Because if it's a support and Disruptor. Yeah, Brewmaster. Yeah, so offlane is Spirit Breaker. Now, what's Brewmaster going to get in this offlane? If that is just an offlane Brewmaster and not some kind of aggressive dual lane or tri lane, or I struggle to see how this Brewmaster is going to get value in main.
Well, even if it's a dual lane with Witch Doctor and Brew, they're going to be against, what, Razor, Venge, and Disruptor? I'm assuming Razor's going to be safe lane. I don't see why they'd throw mid when they've got that Queen of Pain. But either one, if it's Razor or Queen of Pain up against the Brewmaster, I agree with you. What is he actually going to accomplish down there? Also the fact that he's not a hero that can head into the jungle and farm up there. He can't flash farm, he can't get to that Blink Dagger any other way than getting early last hits on lane or possibly some lucky kills.
And now we have another role swap, this time on Underminer.
Yes.
Because JNY played Wisp last game.
This is another team that does this constantly. And it always confuses me because Cloud switches between like safe lane and mid. CK switches between support and off lane. They're always jumping around and you're never quite sure what player is going to play which hero.
Oh, hang on. CK was playing Tiny last game and now he's Witch Doctor.
And no. CK was playing Spirit Breaker. Visson was playing the Tiny. Cloud was on the Troll.
Okay, that's a slightly more reasonable change. If it was from one position to support, I'd find that a bit more strange. Although, hey, Fear does that at EG every now and then, True. So who am I to ask?
But I'm pretty sure they've done that before. They've had JNY switch to offlane or support. They've had Boys going on offlane as well. So they've got all these players that can just go wherever, depending on the hero. And Nahas says this quite a lot. It's definitely a tool in your arsenal that a lot of teams need. Because you're drafting often to a certain playstyle rather than to fit your individual players. So if you've got someone who plays, or if you've got two people that play individual heroes really well, but you need a certain playstyle from them, or you know you want some aggressive player in the offlane, you put your more aggressive player up there. Whereas if you want the mid lane to be more farming, you put your more farm-oriented oriented player there. So it's nice to be able to switch it up.
I agree that it's nice to be able to switch it up. I agree that people should play the hero that they're more suited to in given the draft. But I think some teams do this and they're not really equipped to do it. And while Jesse Vash running, what? Is he not going to get fissured off?
Well, he is now. He places the Observer down, but triple shrapnel, Jesse Vash. Man, oh man.
That was not entirely efficient. I feel like he should be able to die with one, maybe two shrapnels if everyone's ready. But yeah, just going back to what we were talking about, I do think that there's teams who have figured out that this is what the top teams do. They switch around roles every now and then, depending on which heroes they pick. And I think there's other teams that copy that when they're not actually fully equipped to do it. I mean, it's not every team that has like multiple versatile players that can just be in every lane and in every role. So it can be a weakness as well, I think, forcing that kind of role change on yourself when one or more players aren't actually properly comfortable with it.
Yeah, like you look at EG and they've got Sumail and Fear, who can switch up between mid and one role, then Secret with Zyar, TZ. It's not really a big jump to put one mid and then put one off lane, put one in the jungle. So they can all play pretty much every... It also comes from the fact, obviously, they've been playing for a long time on different teams, and then joining these joining these bigger brands, they've, you know, sort of been forced to move off their regular role that they were playing for a long time before that, and now they're being, you know, put into a role that they haven't really played. Or
so we've been talking so much during the start of the game. It's actually an off lane Razor. Is that just because they figured that there'll be a safe lane Shadow Fiend? Or
oh, this is some super mind games. Some super, super mind games. I don't know. Because the way I was looking at this, I'm thinking... So it's Raven, safe lane, Spirit Breaker, farming. The way I looked at it, I thought, okay, they need a ranged hero up against the Brewmaster just to harass him out. But with Vengeance Disruptor, they've got more than enough actual harass damage there. Razor does very well 1v1 against Shadow Fiend on the safe lane. Mid, I was a little more unsure about it because, you know, you've got the two ramps and you don't have the same opportunity to run a long distance with Static Link going, whereas this off lane, it's a long lane.
Yeah, this Razor, I think he would struggle if it was a tri-lane, but fully aware that the Earthshaker wants to roam. Witch Doctor can't zone him alone, Witch Doctor's just gonna get destroyed and Shadow Fiend won't be able to help. So if the Witch Doctor's just gonna pull, then the Shadow Fiend's gonna lose the lane 1v1. So all because they know that the Earthshaker wants to be mobile, they can just run this offlane Razor and get great value out of it at this point anyway.
You can tell the boys doesn't really know where to go. He wants to stick mid to try and defend Vissen, because as soon as he leaves, the Queen of Pain just jumps straight up and throws Shadow Strike down. Jesse,
yeah,
Vash.
But if he goes to top, mid's in trouble. If he goes to mid, top's in,
yep,
like really not getting a great trade against a solo offlane Razor.
Oh, Nicole. Is he actually going to dive this? No, he turns back around onto Cloud. He's still got level 2 Razors ready to go. Medium Raze and then hit. Well, they got the Fisher as well, so another kill there for Underminer. The Razor playing, yeah, a little bit too aggressively there, just on a support Witch Doctor, but mid lane, Sniper drops. Jesse Vash with that smoke does manage to make a movement.
That's, yeah, exactly what we spoke about. Earthshaker spotted top and perfect time for Queen of Pain and Venge. Just go for a kill on mid.
Oh, JNY is hasted up down at the spot, rune spot. QQ gonna have to glimpse him back over. JNY, are you gonna continue chasing here? He's got another clap and Disruptor might die. Needs some lucky crits, maybe a few more hits. Raven jumps in with a charge and then another bash on top, then blocks the path. So well played by him, just stopping the advance of the Brewmaster from chasing down that Disruptor any further.
Just raise it? No. He had Maledict on him. Ticked pretty low, but didn't go down. Just a level 1 Maledict. If it was level 2, I'm pretty sure he would have died.
But he's forcing so much regen. Shadow Fiend now has no more tangos. Witch Doctor has used all of his clarities, has one tango left. Disruptor killed by a neutral creep? I don't think that was not intentional. He was trying to stack up the large camp. I saw it returning back in. So I'm guessing that he was on super low HP, tried to stack, but he's a ranged hero. How does that happen? Nicole! Long range Raze from Cloud takes him pretty low with an extra right click as well, so Razor has to watch where he's standing.
Yeah, this Queen of Pain versus Sniper lane, it's a lot like the Storm Spirit versus Sniper lane in the sense that when Queen of Pain hits level 6, Sniper is just going to die unless Earthshaker is standing there like at that instant. I think pretty much the second she gets 6, if she can see the Sniper, she probably just goes on him.
Yeah, even if the Sniper turns around and gets a couple of lucky headshots, there's not really too much you can do. This is the most annoying thing though. Now as a Queen of Pain against heroes like Sniper and Shadow Fiend, you go on top of the ramp, they turn around and hit you. No. Boys has managed to block himself and Sniper away from this rune, but I don't think Vissen really wants to go any closer. A blink scream.
I think he tried to go attack the rune and realized the Fisher was blocking his path.
Yeah. Now QQ is headed up top on this Disruptor, so leaving Raven 1v1 against JNY. Sure enough, Jesse Vash is TPing top, was standing around, what the hell? QQ walks straight past the Witch Doctor as Jesse Vash comes in with a magic missile to Cloud. That's going to be the first kill. CK trying to get as much damage down onto that maledicted Razor. He's going to drop, no. Still surviving through it.
And at the same time, Queen of Pain takes down Sniper mid, even though Earthshaker was there. Earthshaker fissured her, and I mean, that's the kind of advantage Queen of Pain has in this lane at this point.
Even without using Sonic Wave?
Yep. Well, that's the Sniper was on half HP, so if he's full HP, it'll take the Sonic Wave.
Oh man. Shadow Fiend tries to TP top. QQ walks straight up to here and fakes out the glimpse. So Shadow Fiend just cancels the TP, realizing he's going to waste even more time by TPing, getting glimpse back, and then having to walk all the way there. So he just figures, well, I'll walk into the jungle. I'll take one of these stacks that's been made up by me by the Earthshaker. Boy's doing a pretty good job down there. JNY taking some pretty heavy sustained harassment here from Raven.
I'm just wondering when Sniper's gonna die next. Earthshaker's ferried himself some clarity so he can try cover, but last time he got the fissure off and it wasn't enough actually to stop a kill. But then
JNY dropping low, no glimpse, no disruptor. The two supports are missing from this bot lane as Raven and Nicole both battling it out. But the Razor moving down here, do they start giving farm priority to the Razor? Does Spirit Breaker now, he's got treads and the majority of the way to earn, he moves up to top just to battle it out up there? Or is it time for him to look for kills?
Yeah, he's gonna gang. I think he just got level 6, it's time to gang, that's their plan. And Sniper's just got a big red target on his head right now, I think he's about to get charged. And
Mineski are pinging out their own Spirit Breaker saying, look, we can see the Sniper. It's time to go. Do they have vision on him anymore? They do now. Yep, there goes the charge. Switch the vision. Nicole's already here. Glimpse back's going to cancel Static Link, though. Doesn't really matter too much. Five heroes go towards mid lane to kill the Sniper. Holy crap.
I just wonder if the Spirit Breaker was saying, you guys can actually kill without me. Why are you asking me to charge this guy?
Why do you need me? Shadow Fiend is leading in terms of last hits. But item progression he has close to nil. Treads and bottle on the safe lane isn't the best. Another charge up on top lane, okay. Raven finds CK. Another couple of hits here. Doesn't really need a bash even. Does get stunned up and maledicted. Has to be careful how much damage he takes.
He's dead. He must be.
Oh, nope. TP like just in time. As he landed with that TP, he takes the maledict hit.
Well, Queen of Pain's still not using the Sonic Wave. She could have actually used it there to make the Spirit Breaker's life a lot easier, but I suppose since he made it out okay, no one's gonna be holding it against her.
Guess what? Sniper's being charged again. Jesse Vash is here, but the follow-up isn't ready.
Is the Earthshaker covering?
720 HP, it's not going to be enough. Yeah, they have to cancel the charge there. Boys, cancelling animation of the fissure, saying, you know what? Go on the Sniper, I dare you. And now four people react from Underminer just to help out Vissom at mid.
Yeah, that's the problem, really. You were saying it before, Spirit Breaker is a hero that's really good at this. Just kind of getting them to react and then pulling out and not actually doing anything. It's a pretty clowny way of creating space, but it actually works really well. And they know how easily the Sniper can die to various different combinations of heroes, so whoop, here's another charge.
Are they going again? Tucci has blink, but this is pretty deep. The Fisher is not gonna cancel the charge. Raven still going in with another strike. Gets stunned up and locked down by Enchant Totem. Glimpse sends JNY back. Tucci is stuck in the trees. Raven is falling. Does Queen of Pain go further here? She's got blink scream. She's got Sonic Wave ready now. Yep, goes in. Scream onto two. Sonic Wave on the catching the Earthshaker, not actually getting the Sniper there. And Queen of Pain's gonna fall. Or not. Stick charges allows her to turn things around and get the kill back onto Sniper. That was odd.
Yeah, blinking into the trees kind of ruined that whole dive. It's really an awkward thing to do while you're diving a tower. But yeah, they still got two kills out of it. 2-for-2 in the end, I think.
Another charge on mid. QQ looking for the glimpse back. Yeah, he's going to get it. Just a little bit closer, so Raven gets in there onto Cloud, forcing TPs again. The Raze back onto Disruptor though. Now another Raze, Jesse Vash dead. Two supports for nothing.
They're not going to mind having TP'd. They got two kills.
Charge. Queen of Pain. Okay, they're going to look for this now. Cloud tries to throw the short range Raze. Tucci with a scream. Just enough to finish off Cloud, but he channels the Requiem. The double Requiem down, taking the Spirit Breaker out with him. Nicole, what is this from Mineski?
I feel like before the series started, these teams made an agreement that they would just be bloodthirsty and aggressive, and both teams... The same thing happened in Game 1. For about 15 minutes, we had just back and forth, people constantly dying, fighting, dying. Then all of a sudden, between like 15 and 20 minutes, Mineski just like were like, hey, we're much richer than you. We have all these important items. We're just going to win the game.
Queen of Pain is still sitting on 5.3k. She bought anything? Okay. She's heading into Orchid now. The first Oblivion staff is ready 10 minutes in. But the last couple of fights, you've given Shadow Fiend and Sniper quite a lot of gold. These are heroes that had nothing whatsoever. SF might actually die up here. The Death Ward's popped and thrown down onto the... Oh, Razor. Draining a lot of damage, but is also sustaining a lot. Cloud going to get bashed up here. Raven with another bash before the Nether Strike and then chases down CK. Can you close the gap on him? Okay, you can't. Boys is ready with a Fissure. Are they really fighting this? Spirit Breaker just charges straight back into you. CK has no mana left. Raven, a couple lucky bashes with the Urn Charge. Secures that kill. I don't know.
There's another charge coming up soon. We do have a magic missile already, so if Earthshaker were to show his face, he'd also die. This is the difference this game, even though Shadow Fiend has a lot of gold, is that he's the furthest thing from snowballing or even being able to snowball. There's no stacks waiting for him, and he's bought an Ogre Club, so he's starting his build defensively, going straight for that BKB, just because of the amount of pressure being put on them. And I think that's going to change things around quite a lot, because it just doesn't seem like anybody on... Oh, yep, dead Brewmaster. I was actually going to say Brewmaster's the tank, the tankiest of all of them.
But...
because it doesn't seem like anyone on their team can not get burst down by Mineski.
Well, Brew was running around with about a half HP. Tucci saw this and thought, okay, it's time for a kill. There was no chance Brew could pop Primal Split or any way he could retreat from that. So Tucci well on the way to Orchid now. How far away are you? About 650 or so? Away from that last quarterstaff plus recipe. Oh, Sniper. Sniper, Sniper, Sniper. Running into the river up against the Spirit Breaker isn't the best move you can make. Queen of Pain's even closing the gap here. Ready with a blink. They've got the charge, and there's the blink. Shadow Strike and Scream. Okay. Scream was held to try and steal the kill, it looks like. Tucci stunned up with a Death Ward and Maledict. This could be enough to kill. In fact, it looks like it will be, as Raven is brought down as well. So they kill the Sniper, but they're losing a couple of heroes in return. Okay, Tucci, Magic Stick, and Bottle Charges with a TP back to Fountain.
Yeah, the ES had to choose there who he was going to Fissure up, because that person would die and the other one wouldn't, and he decided to Fissure the Spirit Breaker, give his Shadow Fiend a kill. Doesn't seem like the aggression's going to stop, and to be honest, why would it? I feel like Mineski, even when heroes are dying, are getting pretty decent trades here. They're pretty much always killing a core when they do dive. And they're getting at least as many kills as they give up.
I think one of the biggest things, you know, you noted that Shadow Fiend's item progression was defensive to start off with. He's also still 1,000 gold away from that BKB. But I'm looking at Brewmaster and realizing he's 500 away from Blink. That's going to be a key item from him. If they keep on this pressure, sure, they're losing heroes, Mineski are. But they're doing this. They're stopping JNY from getting the Blink, so that initial burst in aggression from Underminer is never going to actually come to fruition. Vissom TP's in, is going to get crushed here by the Razor. Double Raze from Cloud. Going to try and do as much damage as he can to Disruptor and brings him down before he himself will bite the dust. CK has Death Ward. Oh man, if he can get a couple of kills here, the Requiem and Death Ward bash from Raven. Stop CK, but 4-for-3 trade? Queen of Pain still alive down on the spot lane.
You know, the psychology involved, I just love it. The way Mineski are playing, and Underminer just kind of feel like they have to respond in kind. Whenever they dive us, we need to all TP there, but Sniper just TP'd into the mid tier 1 and died. Did nothing at all. I mean, that's a position a Sniper just can't TP into. But I think it has a lot to do with the psychology, the dynamic involved in this game of, like, they're going to keep diving, and if we don't constantly reinforce with numbers when they do dive, they're going to get those kills for free. So everyone just goes. But if you're the Sniper and you have Phase Boots, like Wraith Band, Ring of Aquila, you know, yeah. You have no business teeping into the middle of a dive because you're going to just become the target straight away.
Also, one of the biggest issues is that the Brewmaster hasn't made his presence felt. In the first 10 minutes, you know, fair enough. He was bot lane trying to battle it out, get his Blink Dagger as quickly as possible. How do they see...
There's a Sentry Ward.
Okay.
Was looking for Obs Ward, just happened to find an Invisible Witch Doctor.
That's really unfortunate. But yeah, the Brewmaster tried to get Blink on bot lane. He goes mid to try and, you know, get into his first fight. He's got Primal Split, why not? But Disruptor was level 6 already. That's the most Like, pathetic death ever. Raven charging into the Witch Doctor and finishing him off with a bump. Cloud gets a kill onto Queen of Pain with his dying breath. Quap with the last hit, triggers that Requiem. That's a one-for-one trade there.
Yeah, and he's... The SF will have BKB for the next fight, and the Brewmaster's going to have Blink. And that's going to be their chance, really, to come back into the game if they win that fight with those big two pickups.
How many heroes did they lose before that, though? Because Sniper's charge is found in the trees.
Yep. It's hard to imagine a way in which Sniper becomes relevant again in this game, unless his Shadow Fiend and Brewmaster just take a big fight for him now and make him some space. Because if they're going to keep having these fights, the Sniper actually at this point is less useful than the supports, I want to say. Like, he's just like an ATM for them to withdraw some gold from.
Yeah, at least the Earthshaker has Fisher. Witch Doctor has done a lot this game. Maxing Maledict has been great for him. He's found some pretty damn good kills with his level 2 Death Ward, which is up now. But Sniper, is he just a walking assassinate? He just has to stay as far back as he can. Cloud pops the BKB, and now JNY gets to show off his shiny new Blink Dagger as he gets in there, claps Nicole, pops the Primal Split. Now they're chasing down Razor. Requiem onto the Spirit Breaker. That was perfectly timed. Doesn't insta-kill him, but they're still going to find, what, two or three kills here for nothing.
Yeah, precisely the fight that Underminer needed to happen, but I wonder, did nobody on Mineski look at Shadow Fiend's items? If they saw you at the BKB, that plan just made no sense.
Well, I think the BKB would be fine, because they can swap him. They've got right-click attacks, they've got minus armor from the Wave of Terror. So they see the BKB and think, well, he's still squishy. He's not going to survive through our actual physical attacks. Razor can still right-click him. Spirit Breaker can still get in there. It was the Blink from Brewmaster, which they thought, oh, we've shut him down so much. Surely he can't have Blink by now. Surely he's not going to jump in and do anything.
I have a feeling they were surprised by both. Just by the way they charged the SF, and the second he BKB'd, they turned around to run. And that's when the Brewmaster caught them. So I think they're just in kind of YOLO mode. Didn't consider either item, and both came back to bite them. And I wonder if Mineski slowed down the pace of the game now, or they're just going to try and become more strategic about their diving.
Well, they still have objectives to take in the tier 2 towers on all three lanes. Roshan hasn't been touched yet. Razor farming up the jungle. He has a broadsword.
He's buying a blade mail. He's definitely buying a blade mail.
See, you say that. Queen of Pain? Who was she trying to kill? Did she just go in and try and solo kill the Witch Doctor?
Yeah, behind the tier 2. And didn't work out for her.
No way.
I'm surprised.
Does that sentry actually not see that? Okay, well, bot lane. QQ gonna get harassed down, and then a Fisher. Does seal the deal. Are you 100% sure that's a blade mail? Charging from Raven onto Vissen. The Sniper getting caught out here with the Echo Slam back onto Nicole. They're going to finish off the Sniper, but where's the Razor? Swap back by Jesse Vash, in fact. Boys? Okay, swap back, but then jumped and clapped by JNY on the Brewmaster. Charge again. Earthshaker gets stunned up. Primal Splits popped, though. Raven stunned by the Boulder Toss, and CK makes his entrance. Stun, Maledict, no Death Ward, though. If they had this Death Ward, it'd be a pretty simple kill into Raven, so they're just going to have to try and right-click him down for as long as they possibly can. Maledict will finish him off.
Earthshaker in a really funny position there, where he had Urn killing him. So he's trying to run away, but he's also trying to stay in range of the Witch Doctor heal. Manages to stay alive, or Brumos has been glimpsed back. He's definitely going to go down.
Silenced, held in place with the Kinetic Field and Magic Missile, and finally brought down. Shadow Fiend has been running rampant on this top lane, though. They have completely ignored top as he pushes into tier 1, takes a couple of creep waves, then backs up into the jungle.
So, I was saying that the supports are doing more than... Just look at Witch Doctor's net worth. It's overtaken snipers.
Pretty crazy. Even the Brewmaster, who was off lane and had an absolutely awful time. Do you just go... What do you build on this sniper? Do you still go in for Mask of Madness? Because you're going to die anyway. So I see it, if you can pump out more damage, then that's a good thing. BKB isn't going to be that great. How did they suddenly see that Observer Ward? Do they have a gem or something? Yeah, Witch Doctor has a gem.
Yeah, Yeah, that's what he's just bored with his action head with, and Razor does buy the blade mail. Because that's, I just feel like that's the style that Mineski's going for. They seem quite committed to it, they don't want to compromise even though the big items have come out, and I feel like that's very possibly a mistake, because if they're going to keep hitting their head against the door, they lose one or two more fights, they go behind. I mean, sure, Sniper's underfarmed, but at this point, Underminer could probably win the game with an underfarmed Sniper if they take one or two more big fights.
Gen Y, they've got the Orchid down on him, so he can't split. Even if he wanted to, in fact, it's still on cooldown, but nevertheless, good move there. Razor gets picked off in the back by CK. He looks like a solo kill with the Maledict and Death Ward. I guess Help of the Fisher is pretty damn good as well. Charge down to Vissom, glimpsed back away from Raven, actually. And now with no Nether Strike, nothing to follow up. Shadow Fiend comes in, double raise down onto the Queen of Pain, drops her low so she has to escape. Sonic Wave completely whiffing. She thought the SF would be following and chasing her down. I don't know. This game.
Yeah. I just feel like Mineski are absolutely throwing away what was a really, really big lead just because they don't want to compromise their playstyle. They were having so much fun. I really think it is that they were having so much fun being super hyper aggressive. And even though there's important items on the other team now which stop them doing it, they want to keep doing it.
And we're going to see a blink on Sniper. He's got 2,100 gold. If he was going BKB, he would have bought the Ogre Club. Yeah, it's blink.
Yeah. Which, I mean, I think it hardly helps him, to be honest, to stay alive. If what they want to do is 5-man dive snipe, I mean, there's a glimpse to bring him back if he blinks away. So as long as they have any kind of vision, they get the lightning off, or Cop can blink at him. But at this point, Sniper could just be used as bait. I mean, if they dive Sniper and he blinks away, just stalls a little bit, so what if he dies? Like, the rest of his team's gonna clean up.
I'm still unsure what I'm actually watching here. Underminer smoking up behind the Shadow Fiend. Cloud is being used as bait initially, with Sniper standing as far back as he bloody well can. Mineski not faulting for it though.
Well, Raven is farming the Spirit Breaker is farming a stack.
He sends a dog troll up onto the cliff. That poor troll, he can still hit though. Hitting away.
He's nearly got a BKB, so maybe they finally have just slowed down a bit and said, let's get some important items on our side too. Because Quap's also about to get BKB. They're gonna have two big BKBs. And possibly with the Razor's Blade Mail, maybe those three items they'll feel like, okay, it's time to dive again. But I like that they're showing some level of restraints, because it really felt like for a little while there, they were just gonna keep going at it until they lost the game.
What's Shadow Fiend making? Is that going to be a Skadi with the ultimate orb? Mantis style? I don't know. Gets you out of the Orchid, but you've got a BKB for that. You don't really need it.
It's probably a Skadi. I mean, that's really what's in season at the moment, isn't it?
Tucci? No. Brewmaster gets his split off and goes straight in for Vengeful Spirit. Raven pops the BKB, but he's got no teammates to help him! Razor even walks into the middle of the fight, gets caught by a Death Ward and Echo Slam. Is that just game over? Spirit Breaker? Oh man, he's fissured and stuck. Does manage to TP himself away.
I think the reason the Queen of Pain runs in there is to try and bluff the Shadow Fiend into wasting his BKB. And ironically, she died so fast that she couldn't even use hers.
Yeah!
I think she just wanted to run in, he'll BKB, and then she'll blink out. I think that was her plan. Because there's nothing else she could have been planning to actually get done there.
Well, an Underminer in a pretty good spot to take game number two. This game lasted as long as game number one. 25 minutes in. I guess it was a little bit sooner than Mineski were taking racks in game number one. But 5-man TP out. No, the glimpse. Cloud still caught here. There's a Fisher from Earthshaker ready to go, though, just to try and save the Shadow Fiend. He has to launch it in a perfect position, though, so SF still has a route out, but he's not fast enough.
Yeah, well played by QQ, I think. That's glimpse. Really important, actually. I mean, we were saying a moment ago that Underminer could actually be going for the Raxes. Instead, they decide to go back, showing a little restraint themselves, but the way in which they retreated, getting their SF picked off, is this just a free rush? I mean, can rush be contested without SF?
They've got no primal split. The sniper doesn't offer anything in the way of damage. He's got 900 HP, so I'm going to say no, Roshan can't be contested, but I don't know. I actually don't know. Mineski with 3 stand-ins may now have the lead again. They find CK and the charge is still going forward. CK gets a nice casket. Maledict on 2. Jesse Vash and Tucci both dropping pretty low. And the charge is cancelled, so they don't follow through on it. Glimpse? Is Jesse Vash going to die?
Yep.
Did they not want to earn him with Spirit Breaker? Earn?
I don't know. Is this, by the way, out of interest, is that like a counter to Venge? I mean, it's just funny. Vengeful Spirit is this thing that when she dies, you get this Vengeance aura. Less damage, but I don't know if, maybe it's because Witch Doctor was dead. The aura just went nowhere.
Is it one of those things that if you right click, if you get a kill with right click rather than getting a kill with a spell, how does the Vengeance aura actually work?
I think it's whoever does the lethal blow.
If Vengeance Spirit is slain, her killer will be possessed with a negative Vengeance aura, reducing the damage of her killer and its nearby allies.
Yeah, he's got it. He's got it. Now that he spawned, he's got it. So okay. It was on him for like 2 seconds and then she respawned as well. So it's just because he was dead.
Okay. Well, Mineski now with Aegis Immortal. Queen of Pain looks pretty happy to just jump in and find solo kills possibly. Sniper with a blink back though. Not gonna find that one. Ancient's being taken by Cloud and JNY. Brewmaster's building up into a BKB, and that's a full Skadi completed on the Shadow Fiend.
And Earthshake has a blink now too. I don't know. I wanna say that Underminer are stronger. But there is that Aegis up on Mineski.
It depends about positioning of the team fight. And who gets the initiation? Because if Brewmaster can blink, clap, and split into, you know, 2 or 3 heroes from Mineski, then Underminer have a massive advantage. Then Witch Doctor, Sniper, and Shadow Fiend can all follow through, and, you know, people will be running around trying to get away from the Brewmaster split. Then Earthshaker can find a decent Fissure, a good Echo Slam.
Well, hang on. Sniper's follow through is like throwing shrapnels and ulting. I mean, he really, at 30 minutes, he's got no DPS at all with his hits. But I think what's fortunate for Underminer is that they've got 2 supports that can really make up for that.
Yeah.
The Death Ward and the Ears of His Dagger. So, you know, if it wasn't for the supports, this game could come down to Mineski kill Shadow Fiend and then that's the fight over. But I think if they all in on the Shadow Fiend, there's actually plenty of stuff that could deal with them. The Paralyzing Casks, the Earthshaker, the Brewmaster, everything jumping on them.
I think the Static Storm onto heroes like Brewmaster, ES. You know, the offlane and the 2 supports, if they get a Static Storm onto 1 or 2 of them, then the fight could be lost just with that. So the Disruptor has a lot of work to do. He's got to place this Kinetic Field Static Storm very carefully. JNY being charged, and then, yeah, Raven cancels.
I think a fight's going to erupt pretty soon. Because there's an Aegis, and because of the way Mineski played all game.
Like, right now?
They've tried to show the restraints, but it's like, it's been enough time now, we need the taste of blood again. I'd be surprised if they go back here.
Well, boys, blinks in, 2 man Echo Slam, here's JNY, but there we go! Static Storm at Kinetic Field, taking out the Brewmaster and Earthshaker. Quap dies the first time, Cloud with his BKB, life-stealing and healing through pretty much everything. Vissom blinks forward to get the kill there onto the Razor, onto the Spirit Breaker, even Cloud. Oh, man. Manages to kill the Quap before she can kill him. Jesse Vash dropping low to the Maledict. QQ sends back CK. Underminer winning a pretty big team fight here. And it all started with that Blink Echo, Blink Clap.
Spirit Breaker brought back. He's charging in. This fight's not over.
What can he clean up? Vengeful Spirit still throws out the Wave of Terror. 4 are dead. Spirit Breaker jumps onto CK. Nope. Nether Strike still on cooldown. The Maledict, the right clicks. Raven charges off cooldown in 4 seconds, but he's just brought back into death. Okay, yeah, the sniper is now on a mega kill streak.
Yeah, and he's also fourth in net worth. I mean, this really sums up the game Mineski's had. Like, they slowed down for very little bits to get their BKBs, but for the most part, just like boundless aggression. And it's what started winning them the game, and it's also what's pretty much going to lose them the game too. I'm quite comfortable saying that right now. And this is why I always talk about how the early game is not determinative in this metagame, in this patch. The team that dominates the early game and tries to snowball off it. I mean, Mineski got it right last game, but this game, yeah, just being like, okay, we're being aggressive, it's working, and just like, no matter what happens, just constantly keep being aggressive. And after they lost the first one or two fights, they kept at it and kept losing fights, and they're gonna lose the game for it, I think.
Yeah, the biggest... Oh, man. QQ four-staffs himself into Sniper, and CK is here. Doesn't have the paralyzing cast because he just used those on neutral creeps. But it looks like the disrupt is dead. But Mineski's aggression, you know, it was keeping the Sniper and Brewmaster down. But they could focus on those two heroes on one side of the map. Shadow Fiend, you kind of mentioned that Underminer were TPing a lot of people in to defend these fights and try and, you know, keep the momentum down for Mineski. But SF was that one hero. He was top lane, he was in the jungle, he was continually farming and building up items. While Mineski were charging behind tier 2, tier 3 towers, killing Sniper and Brewmaster over and over again, it's that concept where, look, here's a Vengeful Spirit, here's a support, you've killed her 6 times in 10 minutes. If you continue killing her over and over again and focusing all of your time, effort, mana and cooldowns on this support kill, it doesn't matter as much as the one hero that you're ignoring for 5 or 6 minutes who is free farming and building up a massive bank.
Oh, is there going to be another glimpse? No.
I've got no vision on high ground just yet. Queen of Pain blinking forward and looking for something. Hey, Cloud has BKB though. And then good Fisher again from Boys. Blinks in, Echo Slam with the 2, swaps him back and stuns him up. JNY gets the problem split off with the 3 BKBs now. Nicole and Raven fighting up into Cloud. Death Ward with Aghanim's level 3. Bouncing between everybody on Mineski. Cloud doing no damage with his right click, so he says, screw this. It's Requiem time, boys. That might just be game over now for Mineski as they lose a couple of key heroes with no buybacks left. Cloud has limited damage, but that's going to wear off soon. Jesse Vash, Maledict, right clicks, Vissen with a blink and Yasha. You said that his follow-through isn't really there yet, but with Assassinate, he's got more than enough to finish off that Venge.
Yeah, and this time the Disruptor got the Static Storm slightly too late. Brewmaster already ulted, and that was a big difference maker in the previous fight that made it look so close. Really Underminer way, way, way ahead, and I actually, now that I look at it, I was just thinking about it during that previous fight, is it maybe not to do with the draft? Because I said that Mineski should have slowed down at some point and stopped diving. Especially when the BKB and Blink went up, but what does their draft actually do if they do stop diving? It's pretty much just a diving draft.
Spirit Breaker, Quap, Razor, just running people until you run out of breath, yeah? Even Naha's in chat, just, what the hell? And that's pretty much what, even game number one is, you know, it was one-sided. There was a lot of diving and fighting, but it was nothing like this. I'm surprised the graph doesn't show it as much.
Yeah, I think a draft that's so divey is not very good in the current metagame. And it might be that what they did was correct, that with their draft, they need to just keep diving because they don't have really a game plan for winning any other way. But then the issue is the draft, having this like super divey draft that can't evolve into a farmy or pushy or five-man-y draft that has to just be dive, because that we've seen that many times. That team's almost never win games that way. I mean, last game we said, sure, Shadowfiend did some snowballing, but that was economic snowballing as much as anything else. It wasn't like just constantly like entire team looking for kills.
What supports did Mineski have last game?
In the previous game, Mineski had Disruptor and Earthshaker.
Disruptor?
And Earthshaker.
Okay.
Yeah.
No, I'm just thinking, because quite often when we do see snowball lineups, or well, you know, lineups that like to fight early, there's at least one element that gives some kind of heal. You know, you see Witch Doctor or Dazzle or something along those lines, a mech even. But we're seeing no mech. The only healing item is the Urn on the Spirit Breaker.
Yeah, they had the Viper mech last game, but also more than that, they had Viper as a core and Bristleback as a core. So never mind, the Shadow Fiend snowballed into like high damage, and the Viper and the Bristleback could tank, and so if they got that lead, they could actually force high ground by pushing. They didn't have to like constantly die for kills, whereas this lineup they have this game, it kind of needs to make kills. There's no way it ever breaches high ground. Even earlier on when they were pretty far ahead, there was a stage where they had, I think, 6,000 gold ahead. They couldn't push without making kills. They had to make kills, and that just gives far too much power to the reactive abilities on Underminer. The paralyzing casks, the fissure, the counter initiation with all the BKBs.
Oh man, Raven spots him across the river. Cloud now gets focused down. BKB is popped, but look at where JNY is. He gets Static Storm? No! He can't get his ultimate off. Big Sonic Wave now from Tucci, but the Aghanim's Death Ward from the high ground. Finds one target and bounces a bit to some others. That was really odd. Underminer completely splits up. Cloud with no damage left. But Vissom does manage to find a kill there. Onto QQ as Witch Doctor goes down in the back end of things. Cloud walking up the high ground with his Scotty. Takes down the Ventral Spirit as Tucci is on the retreat. Needs to blink across and find a TP scroll.
Nope. Thanks for standing still, wanker.
Sniper is, yeah, Sniper's a thing now. I mean, this Sniper was a joke for, I don't know, 25, 30 minutes nearly.
I like saying, you know, non-factor, but I don't think non-factor cuts it. He was worse than a non-factor. He was dying over and over again. He was, what, like 3-8 or something? 4-8? Now all of a sudden he's got his kill streak. He's bringing things back and building some items.
So this was a 3-4 trade, but this is a fight where Brewmaster didn't even get ulti off. And that's the closer looking fights have been the ones where Mineski stopped the Brew from getting ulti off. But yeah, that's not going to happen all the time. And they're losing these fights anyway, even though they look a bit closer, they're still losing them.
Sniper with a BKB, Brewmaster still about 400 gold away from his. Base defense time from Mineski. This Observer down in the bot lane does give quite a bit of information to Underminer about where they're moving and possibly where the Spirit Breaker is charging. JNY with a massive old creep wave. Why are you denying your creeps? Surely you want them to push into this tower.
Yeah, but I have bad news for Mineski. I said their draft doesn't push very well, doesn't go high ground really well, it just needs to make kills well. It doesn't even defend high ground that well, in my opinion. Their draft is designed for one purpose and one purpose alone, and that's making kills and trying to snowball more and more kills. But the game is so far from being at a point where that's a thing. I think what it takes at this point for Mineski to just stay in the game is for Underminer to keep splitting up and getting picked off. If they group up as five, I just don't see what Mineski are gonna do.
Roshan has already been taken by Undermine, I'm afraid, boys. But why did Mineski keep running in there?
There's a Shadow Fiend with the Aegis in his inventory, and they're like, smoked as five to Roshan.
Did they not know?
It's just all that bloodlust in their head right now. They can't think straight.
Ah, go and kill stuff! I'm still in shock. Tucci, Aghanim's BKB and Orca, 2,000 gold up on him. At this point, you need to save for buybacks. And back to your point about defending high ground, they don't have, you know, a big AoE ability. Ignore what I said 20 seconds ago about buyback on the Queen of Pain, because apparently, blink forward with your ability, Sonic Wave, and then blink back! But they've got a few elements that are decent at defending high ground, you know, Kinetic Field, Static Storm, they've got Static Link from the Razor up against the Shadow Fiend, Queen of Pain with the Sonic Wave, but they don't have that big Ravage or Black Hole, Reverse Polarity. There's no defining teamfight ability that could turn around a game and, you know, straight up win a teamfight. Raven jumps in on the Vissom, the BKB's pop down, Static Storm not doing a damn thing against that Shadow Fiend who BKB's up. Witch Doctor is glimpsed back to a safer position than he was in, but still gets finished off by the Queen of Pain. Healing up, Maledict is dropped onto the Quab's head as Cloud still chases him down. In the middle of the base, though, Brewmaster sends Ventral Spirit up into the air, stuns her up with a boulder toss, and boys, Fisher locks her down into place. Triple kill now for Cloud as the glimpse back onto JNY again. puts him into a safer position. Ooh, decent sonic wave from Tucci, but Cloud is life-stealing like an absolute madman. Buyback? Quop? Right. We're going to look at this in interactive mode. Let's watch this in first-person perspective. Blinks in, screams, and then blinks back out.
Yeah, they actually did pick off the sniper there. Even though he's finally got items, he could still go down quite fast, but Shadow Fiend with that Mask of Madness, with that Aegis, the BKB, just dishing out damage to every single hero, and this will be the game, and this is going to be a split series.
And I think, unfortunately, that means Mineski are going to be dropping down into relegation. And that's pretty much decided now. Queen of Pain, still going forward, but that's it now. 110 seconds without the Queen of Pain, Spirit Breaker. Have fun! I guess Razor's joining as well, and Cloud now no longer has teammates to battle up with him. So with the Nether Strike, this might secure a kill onto Cloud.
So are they...
Even with no damage, he's life-stealing like a crazy man. Buys back, buys Daedalus. That's a really risky thing to do, though. Buying back in a position like this.
Okay, what is going on?
I don't know! Sniper flicking away at Razor, Nicole losing some serious HP as Jesse Vash swaps him back into safety. Wistosha with a blink goes forward, Cask bouncing once, twice, returns into Razor's face as Assassinate finishes off Venge and QQ is chased down by CK. Just keep on running, Static Storm is final action on this earth. Underminer. Gonna take the last set of racks here. Tier 3 at mid lane, and the ranged and melee rank's gonna fall. They're even warding up high ground. I don't know if it's needed, but they're gonna do it anyway. Why the hell not? Shadow Fiend still doesn't have full souls. Now he does.
A Shadow Blade. And they're like, cool, we have a gem on our Earthshaker that doesn't actually work.
This has to be one of the more unusual series that I have ever cast.
Yeah. So, this puts Mineski at 7-11, because they got one win and one loss.
Correct.
So, I think if 5 ever lose all of their remaining games, that's still a tie for relegation, isn't it?
I don't know.
Because 5 ever is 7-7 right now. I mean, Mineski will be 7-11.
Yeah.
5EVA's got 4 more games. So if somehow 5EVA lose 2-0 series, the Mineski might not get relegated. But they have no control over that.
Yeah,
I
true.
Mean, they're not one of the teams playing.
So Mineski still have a chance, I guess. But that depends on, like you said, 5EVA. This has been one of the stranger series that I've ever seen, but that's it. 1-1. A win apiece. And Underminer looking to keep their place, or at least get into the playoffs for the Pro League. But I've been Durka. You can follow me on Twitter at DurkaDota. Scant, thanks again for joining me. His Twitter at Scantzor. Any final words?
I'm glad it's weekend, because that was a weird and clowny series, and I think it's time to relax now.
Yep, time to relax indeed. Later on today, Cap is going to be casting the Americas division with Pain against E-Hug in about 7 hours' time. Wheel against Rift, and I think that's it. Then tomorrow, we have the game that was meant to be earlier today, Trust up against Underminer. So Underminer will want to be getting some more wins to, you know, get a better chance to stay in the Pro League. But Trust, they're looking for that top spot. They can still obtain it with how many wins did it? If they go 2-0 tomorrow against Underminer, they can tie up with MVP Phoenix, and that puts them on 11-5. And then if they win their series after that, which I believe is against Rave, they can go 13-5 and be secured in that top spot. But thanks for joining us, guys. Tune in later for the Americas and tomorrow for more Southeast Asian action. This weekend is probably going to be, you know, closing out SEA and America to see who gets those LAN final spots. See you tomorrow.